This is your foot. Well, the bones of it. There are 26 bones in your foot. 7 tarsal bones, 5 metatarsal bones, and 14 phalanges. So what we are going to do in this video is to go through all the bones that make up the tarsus, the metatarsal bones, and the phalanges. What's up everyone, my name is Time. I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you would like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. The tarsal bones. Those are the ones at the back of your foot, basically forming the ankle and the rear foot. There are 7 of them in total, and we will go through each one by one. Let's start with this bone here. This is the talus. Now, the most recognizable part of the talus is this saddle-shaped structure on the top, called the trochlea of the talus. This is the part that sits right under the tibia and the fibula. If we look at it from the anterior view, you will notice that the trochlea is actually divided into 3 distinct articular surfaces. This one here is the medial malleolar facet, which connects with the medial malleolus of the tibia. On the other side, we can see the lateral malleolar facet for the fibula. And superiorly is the superior facet. That is the part that directly articulates with the inferior surface of the tibia. These 3 surfaces together, the superior, lateral, and medial, are what make up the trochlear surface of the talus. And what they do is, they form the ankle joint, or the talocrural joint, as you see here. We will go over the joints visually in the next video, but for now, let's keep moving through the bony structures. And to do that, we need to remove the tibia and the fibula, and then rotate the foot this way. We now see the lateral view of the foot, so let's focus on the other structures of the talus now. Since the talus is so large and shaped the way it is, we can generally divide it into 3 parts, the body, the neck, and the head. On the body of the talus, you will find the trochlea at the top, which we just talked about, but there are some other important things here. On the lateral side, there's this small bony projection called the lateral process. This is where the lateral talocalcaneal ligament attaches, helping to stabilize the connection between the talus and the calcaneus underneath. Another thing is, you see this area here in purple? This is called the posterior calcaneal articular facet. This surface connects directly with the calcaneus below, and is one of the 3 surfaces involved in the subtalar joints. Over on the other side, we have the posterior process, so let us rotate the bone so we get a better view of it. The posterior process splits into 2 tubercles, a lateral tubercle, which is where the posterior talofibular ligament attaches, and the medial tubercle, which serves as the attachment site for the medial talocalcaneal ligaments. And right in between these is this groove here, the groove for the tendon of flexor hallucis longus. It runs between the 2 tubercles, and as you see here, it transmits the flexor hallucis longus tendon, which continues forward towards the big toe. Okay, so now what I want to do is go ahead and isolate this bone, tilt it so we can see underneath, and then zoom in. What structures can we find on the neck of the talus? This groove here is called the sulcus tali, a deep groove between the posterior facet and the anterior part of the bone. It's also important because it accommodates the interosseous talocalcaneal ligaments. Next to it, we can see the middle calcaneal articular facet. This is the 2nd of 3 articular surfaces that connect the talus with the calcaneus. Now, let's move anteriorly to the head of the talus. The most obvious surface here is this large navicular articular surface, which connects with the navicular bone. It is part of the talonavicular joint, a very mobile joint in the midfoot. Right beside it, we can also see the anterior calcaneal articular surface. This is the 3rd and final surface that connects with the calcaneus. So that was all I had for the talus. Now, let's move on to this large bone underneath it. This is the calcaneus. The calcaneus articulates with the talus above and with the cuboid bone in front. The first noticeable structure we can see on this bone is this large roughened area back here. This is the calcaneal tuberosity. It's super important. As you can see here, it forms the actual heel of your foot. It also serves as the attachment point for the plantar aponeurosis, which is a thick band of connective tissue that runs from the heel all the way to the head of the metatarsals, helping to support the arch of the foot. Also attached here is the calcaneal tendon, or the Achilles tendon, which is essentially the shared tendon of the triceps serrae muscle group, made up of the gastrocnemius and soleus, as you see here. Also, the plantaris muscle should often insert here as well. Now, if we go back to this view again, and look at the calcaneus from the side, we will notice that the tuberosity has 2 projections. These are the medial process and the lateral process. The lateral process provides origin for the abductor digiti minimi, and the medial process serves as the origin for the flexor digitorum brevis and abductor hallucis, and it also supports the flexor retinaculum. Another structure we can see is the sustentaculum tali, as you see here. This one is interesting. It projects medially, like a little shelf, and what it does is that it supports the head of the talus, which is right above it. And it also gives attachment to some important ligaments, like the tibio-calcaneal ligament, the plantar calcaneo-navicular ligament, which you might know as a spring ligament, and the medial talocalcaneal ligament. And if you look just beneath it, you will notice this groove here. This is the groove for the tendon of flexor hallucis longus, which passes right under the sestentaculum and continues towards the big toe. Another thing we can see is the calcaneal tubercle, which sits just inferiorly. It provides attachment to the long plantar ligament and helps support the lateral arch of the foot. If we now rotate the calcaneus and look at the lateral view, we can also see this bump here. This is the fibular trochlea. It acts kind of like a pulley, guiding the tendons of the fibularis longus and brevis as they course around the lateral side of the foot. Okay, now what I want to do is isolate the calcaneus, rotate it in this direction, and we will get this superior medial view. So let's zoom in. From this angle, we can see a few joint surfaces clearly. Here is the anterior talar articular surface, which connects with the head of the talus. Just behind it is the middle talar articular surface. And then further back is the posterior talar articular surface, the largest one forming most of the subtalar joints. Over here, this flattened area is the articular surface of the cuboid. And this groove running between the talar facets, that's the calcaneal sulcus. Together with the sulcus tali, it forms the sinus tarsi, which we will cover when we get into the joints. So that was all I had for the calcaneus. Let's now go to the navicular bone. The navicular bone is interesting. It lies just anterior to the talus, behind the three cuneiform bones, the medial, intermediate, and lateral. And just lateral to it, we find the cuboid. What we can see clearly on this bone is this bump right here. This is the tuberosity of the navicular bone. It serves as the insertion point for the tibialis posterior tendon, and it also provides attachment to the tibio-navicular ligament, which is part of the deltoid ligament complex, and the plantar calcaneo-navicular ligament, also known as a spring ligament. So that was the navicular. Let's now move on to the cuboid. The cuboid lies in front of the calcaneus, laterally next to the navicular and the lateral cuneiform, and anteriorly it articulates with the fourth and fifth metatarsals. If we now rotate the foot to look from underneath, this is a plantar view, and here we can see two structures. First is this. This is the tuberosity of the cuboid. And the other one is the calcaneal process. The tuberosity here serves as the attachment site for the plantar calcaneo-cuboid ligament, and running through it, we have this curved groove, the groove for the tendon of the fibularis longus. The tendon loops through this groove and crosses the sole obliquely towards the base of the first metatarsal. Alright, so that was the cuboid. Now, let's move on to the three cuneiform bones. There's the medial cuneiform, the intermediate cuneiform, and the lateral cuneiform. So why are they named like this? It's simply based on their position. The medial cuneiform lies on the inner side of the foot, the intermediate sits right in the middle, and the lateral cuneiform is on the lateral side. These three bones lie between the navicular posteriorly and the base of the first, second, and third metatarsals anteriorly. They are wedge-shaped bones that contribute to the transverse arch of the foot. So that was all the tarsal bones. And to remember them, here is a helpful mnemonic. Tiger cubs needs milk. Talus, calcaneus, navicular, medial cuneiform, intermediate cuneiform, lateral cuneiform, and the cuboid. Alright, awesome. Now let's move further down the foot. What we see next are the metatarsals and the phalanges. The metatarsals form the midfoot. You can think of them as the foot's version of the palm of your hand. And the phalanges make up the toes. As you see here, we've got five metatarsal bones. And just like in the hand, they're numbered 1 through 5. Number 1 is on the side of the big toe, and number 5 is on the side of the little toe. Each metatarsal has a base, a head, and a shaft. The base is the proximal part that articulates with the tarsal bones. The shaft is the long, middle portion, and the head is a rounded distal end that connects with the proximal phalanges. What's special about the base though is that if you look at the inferior surface of the metatarsals, you will notice two distinct features. One is this. This is the tuberosity of the first metatarsal. and this serves as the attachment for the fibularis longus tendon. And on the other side, we've got the tuberosity of the fifth metatarsal, and this is where the fibularis brevis muscle inserts. So that was the metatarsals. Now, let's focus on the phalanges. There are three rows of phalanges. We have the proximal phalanx, middle phalanx, and distal phalanx. So let's count them. For the proximal phalanx, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, one on each toe. The middle phalanx only start from the second toe, so we've got 4, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And then the distal phalanx, again, we've got 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So the big toe only has a proximal and distal phalanx, no middle phalanx, just like the thumb. And here you can see them on the foot. It just helps to visualize their position and how they're arranged. Each phalanx has a base, a shaft, and a head. Same structures as the metatarsals. The middle phalanx follow the same pattern, but if you look at the distal phalanx, it's slightly different. We've still got the base and shaft, but instead of a typical head, we have this expanded area at the end. This is the tuberosity of the distal phalanx, which functions like the head and gives attachment to soft tissue. And with that, we have covered the tarsal bones, the metatarsals, and the phalanges. Those are all the bones of the foot. In the next video, we are going to look at all the joints of the foot, how they connect, and how they move. Click the next video to continue learning, and I'll see you there. If you want handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.